Praise God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exhort, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to finish off the topic that we started last week on lameness. So today, we are going to be doing lameness part two, how to be healed. Lameness, how to be healed. And of course, the case study is still the lame man and the short reading. We are just going to finish the book of Acts that we started last week. So we are going to read for today, or for this lesson, Acts chapter 3, verse 4. We start at 11. So we go back to the book of Acts 3. We start from 4 and we start at 11. But before we go any further, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Oh, dear Father God in heaven, thank you for your love. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your majesty. For there is none like you. And so, God, we have come to meet you on this program. Open our hearts, Lord, that we may understand what you are speaking to us. Open our ears that we may hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Open our eyes that we may see deep and spiritual things, that our lives will not remain the same. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, our foundation text is the book of Jeremiah, chapter 32, we start from verse 26, we stop at 27. Jeremiah 32, 26 to 27. Then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, behold, I am the Lord, he is the Lord, the God of all flesh, that is the God of mankind. Of all humans, he created everybody. Is there anything too hard for me? God is asking, is there anything too hard for me? I don't know about you, but my answer is no. Nothing is impossible for our God. Amen. Now, last week we talked about what is lameness, and lameness is an inability to walk. And we also talked about the characteristics or aspects of lameness. Number one is no identification, that is the failure to make impact in the lives of other people. Second one is stagnation, which is to rely on others for sustenance rather than on God. And the last one was starvation, which is to have a limiting mindset. So today we want to talk about how was this lame man healed. We have seen his problem. He couldn't make any difference in the life of other people. He was stagnated. He was stuck in his spot. And he was starved of any potential in his life. So how did everything turn around for this man? How was he healed? So we can learn from him. Number one, expectation. The lame man obeyed and gave his attention to Peter and John as Peter commanded. Peter said, look at us. And he looked at them. He was focused, you see, for a specific purpose. The Bible says, in the short reading you are going to read, the Bible says he was hoping to receive something from them. You see, he was focused for a specific purpose, expecting a definite result. You see, Jesus reaches out both to the saved and to the unsaved. You see, watch this. To a believer, if you are blood washed with the Holy Spirit in you, heaven bound, Jesus calls our attention to himself, so we can come up higher for a greater experience of his unlimited grace and power, you see. Now, to an unbeliever, if you still haven't made up your mind to go with Jesus, if you are yet to believe in Jesus, if you are still a pagan, unsaved, Jesus is calling for your attention too, you see. He wants you to be saved. He wants you to have a place secured for you in heaven by you trusting in him, you see. Now, to look at Jesus is not a one-off look, a happenstance look, no, or a short attention span look, no. Jesus wants us to stare at him. Have you ever caught somebody staring at you? Huh? They are like just gazing at you, looking at you like a mirror, you see. That's the way Jesus wants us to give him our attention. Now, he wants a believer to look at him with expectation through the Word of God, through prayer, in hope, until we see result. Let me back up and say that again, slowly. If you are a believer, a follower of Jesus Christ, a disciple, Jesus wants you to stare at him through the study of the Word of God every day, through prayer, in hope, you see. Not just doing it as a religious duty. That's nonsense. No, don't be a Pharisee. In hope, until you see results. Now, if you are a pagan, you are unsaved, Jesus also wants you to look at him. Oh yeah, he wants to see your face with expectation. And how do you do that? You ponder on the claims of Jesus that you have heard, how he changes people's lives from bad to good, how he can take people from going to hell to coming to heaven with him, how he can turn the life of an alcoholic or a prostitute or a robber and turn their lives around and they become responsible members of the society. You want to ponder on those claims, you see, to know if those claims were true. And you check out the truth from the Bible. Don't just take my word for it. Oh no. You want to check what I've been telling you about Jesus. Check it out yourself, you see. And also ask people that you know around, maybe your neighbor who used to get drunk and would fight with his wife or with his husband, and you used to know them to be a troublesome family, and then one of them gave their life to Jesus, and everything changed. Go talk to them. What happened with you and this Jesus? They will tell you. When you do that, you are doing that with expectation, you see. Now, you can't do all this in a hurry. No. You cannot do it with a careless attitude, but with a deliberate intention. I tell people when they say, oh, I'm an atheist, or I'm an agnostic, I don't believe in Jesus or the Bible. Okay. Are you willing to check out the claims and then just follow the evidence to wherever it leads you? Okay. Then this is the only evidence I have about Jesus. Do you want to start reading the Bible? Oh, no, I don't want to read the Bible. I look at them. I tell them to their faces, you are dishonest. You are a dishonest seeker. If you are honest, you want to see where the evidence leads, you see. And it is in expectation of a definite result that you want to be saved that you do that. You really want to know if this Jesus is true, then follow the evidence, you see. Let's go to the Gospel according to John, chapter 17, verse 7. John 17, 7. This is Jesus speaking to you. If you're a non-believer and you truly, really want to know if Jesus is true, you are searching with expectation. Jesus is saying to you, if you want to do His will, if you really want to know if Jesus is real, you will know concerning the doctrine, concerning what I've been teaching about Jesus, whether it is from God or whether I speak on my own authority. If anyone wills to do His will, he shall know concerning the doctrine, whether it is from God or whether I speak of my own authority. What Jesus is saying is, you won't confirm the evidence until you get into it yourself and find out the truth. So get into the Bible and find out the claims of Jesus. I will tell you more about that towards the end of this program. Now, if you're a believer, the Bible verse for you is Proverbs 23, verses 17 to 18. Proverbs 23, verse 17, we stop at 18. And I'm taking it from New Living Translation. Don't envy sinners as a believer. Don't. While you are waiting in hope, do not envy sinners. But always continue to fear the Lord. While you are expecting God to move on your behalf, continue to fear the Lord. You will be rewarded for this. It's a sure thing. Your hope will not be disappointed. All right? And that is the word of God. Expectation in divine direction is the elevator to manifestation. Josephine Zion, stop. Let's say that slowly because it's so beautiful and we all need it, okay? It's not good enough to be expectant. You can be expectant in the wrong thing, you see. But when your expectation is according to divine prescription through the Bible, then your expectation in divine direction is the elevator to manifestation. Your miracle will surely manifest in Jesus' name. Moving on. Elevation. Simon Peter, seeing that the lame man was fully attentive, hoping to receive something from them, Peter and John, despite being told that they had no money, Simon Peter, knowing the power in the name of Jesus, reached out and said, "What I have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk," you see. And then Peter reached out and took this lame man by the hand and pulled him up. The lame man did not resist. Don't be in the resist party, I tell people, okay? He put his faith in action by putting legs on his belief. He stood up. This was a man that had never stood up, let alone walked in his life. Never. Now, somebody saying, "Come on, get up in Jesus' name." And he did not argue. He complied. He stood up when Peter helped. And by so doing, the spiritual healing, which was invisible, took a physical, visible form. You see. When God's, listen up, please. Listen up. Come closer. When God says you can do something, are you listening? When God says you can do something as a believer, a child of God, that is God pulling you up, like Peter did to that lame man. Failure to agree is unbelief. And that will stifle the miracle. God says, Josephine, go back to college. I want you to go get more education for what I want to use you for. And you're saying, God, I'm not sure. Who's talking now? Huh? Who's going to give you the wisdom? Who's going to give you the knowledge? Who is going to pay for the college? God says, I want you to go for me. You're saying, God, I'm not sure. Really? Listen, nothing gets God angrier more than his children or any of his children to tell God, you made a mistake in calling me to do this. Ooh, all the people that tried it in the Bible, they saw the other side of God, you see. God can understand if you say, Lord, I'm scared. He will encourage you. Lord, I need provision for this. He will give you. But when you say, God, when God says, go do something, and you say, I don't think, no, you should send somebody else. Listen, you will get a slap from heaven. You won't believe it. Okay? So when God is telling you, I want you to do this, that is God asking you to come up. When God says you have been forgiven, stop digging up your past sins. Believers, I'm telling you, I suffered for 10 years when I first gave my life to Jesus, digging up my past. And until God said, enough, I've had enough of this madness, stop it. When God has forgiven you, it doesn't matter what you have done. You have repented and you have been living a righteous life, holy, in the power of the Holy Spirit. In the power of the Holy Spirit, you've been living a good Christian life. Listen, when the devil comes to remind you of your past, you remind the devil of his future. When the devil says you used to abort babies in the past, say, devil, that's why you are going to hell. When the devil comes to you, hey, you used to be a prostitute, devil, that's why you are going to hellfire, you see. Now, to fail to comply with God is to remain in the same spot. Here is another way God reaches out to elevate you. When God surrounds you with encouragers, those who believe in you and believe in what God can do through you, that is another way of God trying to reach out to pull you up like Peter did to that layman. That is why I always emphasize about your circle of friends if you're a Christian. Really, is spiritually stupid as a child of God to surround yourself with naysayers, unbelievers. They're not going to speak anything good into your life, or people who are envious. They tell you, oh, you can't do that. You can't. Or they tell you about other people, everything that is wrong about other people. Listen, if you keep taking that aim, the junk they are giving you is a matter of time. They will tell you what is wrong with you too. They will tell you. You see, many a times when we accuse God of failing to fulfill his promise, or we think that miracles no longer happen in modern times, listen up, watch this. We are the causative agents staying the hand of God from showing his power. And I can begin to give you personal examples from my own personal walk with God, when I have opened my big mouth and complained to God or accused God wrongly of not doing what he promised, and let God be true and Josephine Zion the liar. Because it turned out God fulfilled his own part of the bargain. I was the one that did not comply with God's directives, you see. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. If we believe not, yet he abides faithful. I love my Jesus. He cannot deny himself, never. The book of Psalms says, he will not allow his faithfulness to fail. Oh no. God is as good as his word. And the Bible says, he honors his word above all his names, you see. When God says, I'm going to do something for you, it's as good as done. Because he cannot deny himself. He cannot break his promise. Even if you and I are flaky and we are unfaithful, he remains faithful. Deuteronomy chapter 7 verse 9. The book of Deuteronomy chapter 7 verse 9. It says, know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, hallelujah, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him. Do you love Jesus? Huh? And keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. Do you obey his commands? Huh? Do you? If we fail to uphold his principles, we will fail to behold his miracles. Let me say that again slowly. If we fail to uphold his principles, we will fail to behold his miracles. Moving on. So we have talked about expectation. This man was expectant. We have talked about elevation. Peter reached out to elevate this man. Now let's talk about declaration. The lame man began walking, leaping, and praising God immediately. He didn't wait till tomorrow, immediately. People will believe in God's power of transformation when they see and hear our testimony, you see. Please watch this. We do a great disservice to the cause of the cross and to ourselves when we act as secret believers and silent witnesses of Christ. That is not good. No. If you know the cure for cancer, are you kidding me? You won't go on cable news to tell people? Of course you would. And Jesus is the cure for every spiritual problem, you see. Why would you want to keep him to yourself? That is not right, is it? Our declaration glorifies God and strengthens our faith, while at the same time confirms the saving and transforming power of Jesus to the pagans around us. Since followers of Jesus are God's agent of influence on earth, when we declare our faith and share the testimonies of God's miracle in our lives, the influence of the kingdom of God is increased in the world, you see. This is how we increase the influence of the church in the world. The unsaved may decide to believe in Jesus. Lee Strobel, he wrote A Case for Faith. Actually, it's been made into a movie recently. When his wife, 1978 or 79, I can't remember now. His wife became a Christian, and Lee Strobel was an atheist at the time, an investigative journalist. And his wife began to go to church, and he could see the changes in his wife. And he said, I want to see who this Jesus is, because he has changed my wife, and he's taking my wife away from me. She's going to church. She's totally a new good woman. And Lee Strobel began to find out about Jesus, and he began to read the Bible. Well, cut a long story short, Lee Strobel is a big time Christian apologist today. You see what happened when his wife became a believer. The way the woman began to speak and her actions convinced the husband to become a Christian too, you see. So when we show our Christian walk in our conduct, conversation, and character, and our speech to people who used to know us as bad people, they will want to know what happened, you see. John chapter 4, verse 42. Gospel according to St. John, chapter 4, verse 42, and I'm using the English Standard Version. They said to the woman, this was a woman who had been married 5 times, and she's just living up with a living lover, as number 6. So she had met with Jesus, and her life had been changed. So she went to a town to talk about Jesus. So the people now followed her to where Jesus was. This was in Samaria. And the people of our town said to the woman, they said, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world, you see. The testimony of that woman brought the people to Jesus. Let's go to Acts chapter 4, verse 14. Acts 4, 14. And seeing the man, that is the lame man, our case study, who had been healed, standing with them. With who? With the apostles. In those days, if you stood with the apostles, you were in trouble, because they were under great persecution, you see. But he took his stand with the disciples, with the apostles. They could say nothing against it. What do you say, huh? Dr. Rogers would say, the one with an experience, if you have a personal experience or a testimony, the best person that can argue does not have a chance, a ghost of a chance, to argue with you. If I say something happened to me, Jesus did this in my life, do you want to argue that? Really? You see. So when they saw this man, that truly he's standing on his feet, they could say nothing. The Pharisees were shut up. They could say nothing, you see. Because you can't argue with a testimony. When you declare his glory, you repair his body. Let's say that again. When you declare his glory, you repair his body. When somebody, some unbelievers in your family, in your workplace, when they are talking about everything that is wrong with the church, now I'm not talking about Baptist, Methodist, or no, the Church of Jesus, believers, when they are telling you about what is wrong with the church, you tell them about the good things that Jesus has done in your life. That is repairing his body. And when they hear your testimony, they may just want to follow you to your Bible fellowship. Amen. So what have we done so far? How was the lame man healed? He put his focus in the right place with an expected result. That is expectation. Elevation. He agreed with divine pronouncement that he could stand on his feet. Declaration. His speech and action confirmed to others that he was healed. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, all I will ask you, as the Holy Spirit also challenged me when I was preparing this lesson, is that we practice what we have learned in the life of this man. Let's go practice, folks. Let's go practice. It's not good reading the Bible, not practicing it. Let's go practice, okay? May our lives experience improvement through the power of the Holy Spirit and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that for you, and I pray that for me. Now, if you're an unbeliever, listen, I told you to wait, that I will talk a little bit more. I encourage you to get a Bible, okay? Don't take my word for it, please, I'm begging you. Get a Bible, open to the Gospel of John. It's in the New Testament. Look through the index, you'll find the page number, okay? Start reading 10 to 15 minutes every day, same time, for discipline. So that will help you not to miss a day. Start reading, because I want you to find out the evidence yourself. Don't take my word for it. And as you are reading, when you finish John, go to the next Bible, to the next Bible book, which would be Acts, I believe. Then go to Romans. Keep going until you come to the last page of the Bible. Then you decide. Like one cable news will say, we report, you decide. So you go decide after you have read all those Bible prescriptions I gave you. And then judge for yourself. Or alternatively, a link is coming up as soon as I finish praying. You can follow that link. And I encourage you to follow that link. And we talk more about how Jesus changes people's lives, as he did for this lame man, as he did for me, as he did for people that are watching me, who are already in the Lord's body, who are already his followers. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Because you are the only life changer, the only life transformer. And so, Lord, we pray that you give us the grace to practice what we have learned through this lame man, so that our lives can also be moved forward. And for those wanting to pursue the claims and the evidence of Jesus through reading the Bible, Lord, I pray you grant them the understanding. In Jesus' name, amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.